Hello everyone, this is the Women in Science series, and today I'm truly excited and honored to talk with Professor Temple Grandin, an American scientist, inventor, and an autism spokesperson. Professor Grandin is a renowned animal behaviorist and a consultant to the livestock industry. She's also the author of more than 60 scientific papers on animal behavior. And for years, she has been popularizing knowledge of autism, as she herself is an autistic person. Good morning, Professor Grandin. Thank you very much for joining me today.
It's really wonderful to be here.
From a very early age, you always constructed something. So first of all, I would like to ask you, what was the first thing you designed and built?
Well, I spent hours as a young child making a little bird kite that could fly behind my trike. I was a very, very young child. I was maybe six. And actually that kite's described in my book, Calling All Minds, because we need to be getting children out tinkering and making things. There's too much time being spent on electronics. But I tinkered for hours with the bird kite to get it to work, experimenting with different ways of bending the wings, weighting the wings with different amounts of tape. And you learn important problem-solving skills doing that. Kids aren't doing that kind of stuff today. I would make another version of the kite, and I'd lay it out on the ground, and it was real small, it was only about this big. And then I would crank up my trike as fast as I could pedal. And when I finally got it to work right, it would fly behind my trike.
You have designed many so-called cattle handling facilities. What is the purpose of such facilities?
Well, we have large ranches where they might have several hundred cattle, and you have to bring them in twice a year to vaccinate them for veterinary work. I've also done a lot of work at meat plants on designing facilities, truck loading ramps, races and chute systems for moving moving cattle, large numbers of cattle. We have some very big cattle operations in the U.S.
Why did you take up studying animal behavior?
Well, this brings up a really important thing about how students get involved in things. I was exposed to a really good animal behavior course when I was in college, taught by a retired animal behavior specialist who was just teaching a single course. So exposure. And then one of the reasons I got involved in the cattle industry is I was exposed to it in high school. I came from a non-ag background. You see, students have to get exposed to interesting things to get interested in interesting things. And I'm finding this is true with a lot of careers. If students don't get exposed to things, then they don't become interested in them.
So now let me ask you about autism, as you are a great popularizer of knowledge of this disorder. As far as I know, you were one of the first adults to publicly disclose that you were autistic. And
That was in my very, very first book, Emergence Labeled Autistic. And then I went into a lot more detail in my book, Thinking in Pictures. This has been translated into a lot of different languages. I had no speech until age four. I cannot emphasize enough the importance of working with young children that are not talking. Really good early intervention. You know, Einstein today would probably be in an autism program because he had no speech until age three. So autism varies from someone like Einstein or Elon Musk to very, very severe, where the child remains nonverbal and needs assistance with just basic daily living activities. It's a very, very big spectrum.
But as far as I know, again, if I'm not mistaken, the first diagnosis in your case when you were a little child was brain damage.
That's
because
correct.
At that time, obviously, nobody really knew what autism was.
Well, it was 1949 when I would have been diagnosed. My mother took me into a neurologist. It was actually a really forward-thinking neurologist. And she checked me out for epilepsy, and I had no sign of epilepsy. And she made sure, he made sure that I was not deaf. And then the neurologist referred me to a little speech therapy school that two teachers just taught out of their home. and their early intervention methods were as good as anything today. I was in intensive speech therapy by 2.5 years old. You know, if you've got little kids that are not talking, the worst thing you can do is do nothing. You need to get them into a program right away. And if a program's not available, then you need to get grandmothers and people in the neighborhood to work with the child. Little turn-taking games, just teaching them words, always encouraging them to use language.
Mm-hmm.
Because the worst thing you can do with these little kids is to just let them sit in the corner and zone out on electronics. You've got to get them out doing things and interacting with people.
So basically, what do scientists already know about autism? What should an average person like me know to be more aware of what this disorder is? I know it's a long story, but is there any really important...
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry about interrupting, but one of the problems I have is my processor speed is too slow to get the timing just right. Well, you see, at one end of the spectrum, you have the computer programmers and the engineers that bring us this software that we're using right now to talk on. See, autism in its mildest form probably shouldn't be called a disorder. Now, obviously, if a child never learns to speak and can't dress themselves, yes, obviously, that's a disorder. But this is the problem. You see, a brain can sort of be more thinking, interested in what they do, or more socially emotional. At what point does something become a disorder? I've been out to the big tech companies, rooms full of programmers, silent with their headphones on. I'm going to guess a good third of those are probably on the mild end of the autism spectrum. And they're the ones that made technology.
You say you think in pictures.
Yes.
What does that mean?
Well, if you see the HBO movie Temple Grandin, it shows exactly how I think in pictures. Also, I explain it in my book, Thinking in Pictures. All my thoughts are a picture. It's associative. Now, for example, if I think about going to the grocery store to buy something, I now see the store where I shop and where some of the things I buy, like fruit, for example, are located in the store. They come in these big wooden box things the store has them in. You see, and I see that. Now, when I was young, I didn't know other people thought in words. I thought everybody thought in pictures. I didn't know. And some of my very early work with cattle, I looked at what cattle were looking at, and they refused to go through a raceway to get vaccinated because there was a piece of chain hanging down, or there was a shadow or some visual distraction that most people just didn't notice. And this is something I'm really interested in, is how people think. In fact, I've got a new book coming out this fall on visual thinking. In fact, I can show you a copy of that on visual thinking, that where I talk about different ways people think. And there's scientific research that shows that different people think differently. And in autism, you get extreme versions of these thinking. I'm an extreme visual thinker, so that made me really good at animal behavior, at art, design. Also, visual thinkers are really good at mechanical things, fixing mechanical things. Then you have the more mathematical pattern thinker. These people think in patterns. They're your physicists, your chemists, your mathematicians, your computer programmers. And then, of course, you've got people that think in words. And then there's some people are mixtures of the different kinds of thinking. But there's been quite a bit of research that shows that these different ways of thinking actually exist. And the first step is realizing that other people may think differently. Now, when it comes to business, these different kinds of thinkers can have complementary skills. You know, the guy who can fix absolutely anything, but he can't do algebra. That'd be my kind of mind. Then you have your mathematical mind. It's a programmer. And let's take something like, you know, these platforms that we've been doing these video conferences on. Visual thinker like me would design the interface, and the mathematical thinker does the programming. And one of the reasons why Zoom took over is it was so simple to use. That is the programming interface. So you need the coding person, but you also need someone to make a program so that you don't have to get a PhD in engineering to use the software.
Mm-hmm. Professor, what is a squeeze machine? I know this is something you designed a long time ago.
Well, when I got into puberty, I started having horrible panic attacks, just getting scared over just nothing. Any little thing, I'd have a panic attack. And I watched cattle going in a squeeze chute on a ranch to get the vaccinations. And cattle in the US are not very tame. You can't just walk up to them and give them vaccinations. So they have a device to put the cattle in that where they're held between two side panels. So I watched this and I noticed some of the animals almost appeared like they were relaxed. So I went and tried it. And then I built my own squeezing machine, which is described in detail in Thinking in Pictures. And that helped calm me down. Deep pressure can be calming. A lot of therapists now use things like weighted blankets or weighted vests to help some people to be calmer. Deep pressure has a calming effect. And so I built a squeezing machine that would help me to calm down.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned the movie which was produced in 2010. Did you like the movie about you?
I thought they did an excellent job on the movie, and it's titled Temple Grandin. And what I really liked about the movie is it showed how visual thinking works. You know, if people do not understand visual thinking, they'll understand it after they watch the movie. There's a scene in there where the word shoe is said, and about 10 different kinds of shoes pictures appear. That's how I think.
Mm-hmm.
You know, everything has a picture. If I do not have a picture, then I cannot think.
Yes. Now, let me read a quote before we finish, a quote of what you said the other day. I find it really interesting. If by some magic autism had been eradicated from the face of the earth, people would still be socializing in front of a wood fire at the entrance to a cave. This is really interesting. Did you say that?
Basically, what I said is, I also said, who do you think made the first stone spear? It would have been somebody with autism tinkering and chipping on rocks. It would not have been the social yakety-yaks around the campfire in the cave. You see, mm-hmm. You can be more social or you can be more interested in things. Like when I was a little kid, I spent hours working on getting my bird kite to work. Well, that would be similar to maybe some guy, you know, eons ago, trying to figure out how to chip rocks to make a tool like for just to cut stuff. Make a knife out of a rock, you know, and it took a lot of tinkering to figure out how to do that.
Mm-hmm. Professor Grandin, thank you very, very much for joining me today, for talking with me. It's been a great pleasure.
Well, thank you very much for having me. And I want to see the kids that are different get out there and be really successful. One other thing I want to talk about is working skills. These kids have got to learn how to do basic life skills like shopping, learning how to do a job for somebody else. Teenagers on the spectrum need to get jobs, learn working skills. That is something often gets neglected. And I worked with a whole lot of brilliant people that owned metal fabrication companies. And I'm going to estimate that about 20% of these people that own these companies were either autistic, dyslexic, or ADHD. So some of these people can be really, really talented in things like skill to trades and mathematics, working with animals. We need to help these kids that are different to be successful by developing their strengths. We got to develop the strengths, the things that they're good at doing.
Yeah, so what advice would you give to parents who have just found out their 2 or 3 year old child has been diagnosed with autism?
Well, I've got a book called Navigating Autism that's actually going to be coming out in Poland. And one of the things this book really emphasizes is parents need to avoid getting locked into the label. They get so locked into the label, they can't imagine that their kid is even capable of doing anything. I was very severe when I was 3 years old. I would recommend to parents of a three-year-old that they start working with that child like right now. The worst thing you can do is wait. There are no services available. Get some grandmothers in the community to work with the kid. Got to start working with them. Now, let's say it's an older kid that's got no friends at school, you know, kind of the loner kid that's just kind of different. he needs to be, you know, get his skills built up, get friends who shared interests. I was bullied and teased in school. And the only places I was not bullied and teased was where there were shared interests with things such as riding horses or electronics, those where there's a shared interest. Don't get locked into the label. You need to start looking at what your kid can do.
No cóż, jestem już sama. Dziś mam wyjątkowego pecha do połączeń internetowych. Podczas mojej rozmowy z profesorem Temple Grandin połączenie zostało zerwane dwukrotnie i profesor już po raz trzeci nie mogła się ze mną połączyć. Natomiast sądzę, że wszystko to, co najważniejsze i najciekawsze, udało nam się nagrać, a ja jeszcze na deser, jako podsumowanie tej rozmowy, chciałabym polecić Wam szybko dwie książki jej autorstwa, które ja akurat mam. Profesor Grandin jest autorką wielu bardzo ciekawych książek. Dwie z nich mogę polecić, ponieważ je czytałam, czytam i wiem, że na pewno są godne polecenia. Pierwsza z nich, na którą natknęłam się już dość dawno, to Rozwiń swoją wyobraźnię, myśl i twórz jak wynalazca. Z tej książki dowiecie się wielu bardzo ciekawych, fascynujących informacji na temat różnych wynalazców, a także będziecie mogli sami bardzo, bardzo wiele przeróżnych rzeczy samemu skonstruować lub ze swoimi dziećmi. To znakomity pomysł, znakomity sposób na spędzenie wolnego czasu. Druga książka, która została wydana niedawno, to Mózg autystyczny, podróż w głąb niezwykłych umysłów. I ta książka to również skarbnica wiedzy na temat autyzmu i na temat tego, jak funkcjonują, jak myślą ludzie z autyzmem. Serdecznie polecam Wam te publikacje, ale też zachęcam do zaglądania na listy innych publikacji profesor Temple Grandin, bo jest ona, jak zapewne się przekonaliście, jeśli wysłuchaliście tej rozmowy, niezwykle fascynującą osobą.